So, but I also know this, I've learned in D.C., you don't question the motives of a legislator. Okay? There are people on the other side of the aisle that believe wholeheartedly in what they're doing. They believe with all their heart that they're fighting for what is right in their world and representing their people. And I don't question their motives. I don't. But I believe that we're kicking the can down the road. We're kicking the can down the road. We're fighting over $2 billion a week when we got a tsunami of $14 trillion coming our way. So, what's going to happen is, stay tuned. And Jeff, if I ran a little too far.
All right, I voted for the cigar. Look, but there is absolutely no daylight between Steve and I on the issue of spending. My vote was a tax in what we are trying to accomplish. And I will say this. If you remember when we first took office and took control in the House, Harry Reid said there will be additional spending. We're going to ramp spending up. Then he said we're going to freeze spending. And now we've gotten them to vote to cut spending. Now granted, it is a very, very small amount of money, but we have boxed the Democrats in. Now, trying to get them to do exactly as you talk about a perfect storm about to hit. We have the 2012 budget, President Obama's, the Republicans, you have the continuing resolution, and we have a debt ceiling increase that's about to come at us. And I can promise you that our leadership is hearing a pretty resolute call from most members. Unless there is some ironclad spending restrictions and resolutions inside that debt ceiling increase, you're not going to see us vote for it. We're trying to get...
She's been patient. She's...
Thank you. Carmen Reynolds, Navarre Patriot. I just wanted to do an aside on this United Nations issue because we the people have got to count on you to draw a line in the sand and rally the troops. Last May, the United States Supreme Court, for the first time in history, used a United Nations treaty that is unsigned by our country to establish a ruling and overrule our Florida court. So we are in deep kinship. Our leaders view we are in very deep, deep, deep trouble when they use the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child Treaty, unratified by our U.S. Senate, to make a ruling on Graham versus Florida and Sullivan versus Florida. That is the same reason why your daughters, Samantha, Stephanie, Allie, and Abby, may be taken out of your home, or if you're homeschooling them, you may not have a right to homeschool them under that treaty that they really want to be signed in this country. So here's some background on Agenda 21 and all the pieces of education, why they're trying to clamp down on our oceans, our recreational fishing, our charter boat industry, our revenue. It's a many-headed hydra with tentacles that are reaching into everything. And it's affecting the counties, they're working with mayors. But my question surrounds jobs, jobs, jobs. I have two questions about legal and illegal immigration. Money, $113 billion in our country here to support the illegals in our country, of which we have 25 to 31 million unemployed Americans. 8 million illegals in the jobs. Let's take it down to Florida. We have 1 million unemployed Floridians with 750,000 illegals in those jobs. It's costing us $6 billion a year in Florida to support them on the backs of us taxpayers. This is a national security concern. Also, we've got terrorists coming from honoring the legal people that are here, the minorities, our blacks, our Hispanics, our women, our youth that are looking for jobs. And finally, our legal immigrants that did it the right way and waited for years and filled out their paperwork and paid their fees that need jobs. According to Numbers USA, I saw the video today. A woman with a master's degree is willing to wait tables and clean floors. We're desperate for jobs. One question, and then I'll go to number two. Why are both of you not five for five co-sponsors of the five immigration reduction bills that Numbers USA is putting forward? And I know that Congressman Miller has signed up for one, H.R. 692, to end chain migration.
She's on a roll, man. I think I'm maybe three for five. They may be lagging on their website a little bit. But suffice it to say, you're talking to two people right here that get it. On the illegal immigration issue, when President Bush, go back to the Republicans again, when President Bush wanted to start this process of amnesty, he said, no, it's not happening. And they don't like to hear no, but that's what happened. We didn't have, President Reagan's right, it didn't work. And the minute we start talking about allowing people to come across the border and become legal citizens just because they're here, we're a fix.
And at the same time, 2 million are coming across the border per year. We're still allowing 1 million to come in legally with green cards without any reduction in that, with all these American citizens out of jobs.
And you want to know part of the problem, though? In all honesty, and a lot of people won't say this, but I'll say it, you can divorce yourself if you want to. Part of the problem that people in the United States, some people won't take certain jobs, is because they can go to the government and get money from the government, and in some instances make more than doing the job. The people.
Let me say this. I have 70 dairy farmers in Florida CD2. 70 dairy farmers. When those dairy cows have a calf, and that calf's ready to hit the ground at 2 in the morning, if that calf isn't pulled out, they lose the calf and they lose the cow. Okay? There's not a long line of people standing in line to go milk their cows and to pull their calves. Okay? So I have to tell you, when you say that illegals are taking these jobs that no one wants, I just have to tell you, when you go over to the east side of the district, and I have been very clear throughout my campaign, I believe in sealing that border, I don't believe in amnesty, I believe in work visas, I believe if you're here, we need to know who you are, where you're going, and what you're going to do there. I believe that. I believe in welfare reform. I believe the 1996 Welfare Reform Act that took people from welfare to work was great. It was a Democratic president and a Republican speaker, and they got that done, and they reduced the welfare rolls by 74% in this country. That needs to be re-looked at. But I'm not going to agree with you, because if you can collect unemployment for 99 weeks,
there are exceptions.
No, there are more than some exceptions.
But there are facts in South Carolina when the ICE raids go through and they remove 300 within 2 days, the blacks and the Hispanics were in those jobs. So there are exceptions.
Well, let me say this. I know a lot of available jobs, okay, that I'm happy to send people to. And they won't have to wait long because there's nobody standing in front of them. Okay, to the farmers that I represent. In Florida CD2, okay, is the number one ag district in Florida.
Let's open the dialogue. Let's get that information out.
Look, they're talking about it. I mean, you drive down I-10 on the east side of this district, there are a lot of jobs there. Okay? A lot of jobs. And there's 16% unemployment over there. So we're in a historical high, and you know you're from Dixie County.
And finally, the second question, so I get out of everybody's way, is, can you both commit to joining the Reclaim America Jobs Caucus in the House We are Congresswoman Sue Myrick, Congresswoman Mann Lamar Spring, and there's a third one too. And they had the Reclaim American Jobs policy.
I'll be glad to join. I mean, I know them both.
And I'll give these to your staff. Thank you.
Last, we're into your family, John. Last question.
Can the law, Fancy Clark, get the budget submission? Both of y'all know the things we have to take on the federal government for our jobs. I'm here, I'm not looking to create jobs. We've got to create jobs, just red tape and nuisance. Taking the jobs in Pensacola, the town of City, on these days, there's people on the road, there's so many jobs. You guys in the local area, called the Washington dead tape, don't allow people to come in, or just headache, local construction, and then you see the death of the local.
Absolutely.
I think there's a lot of opportunities in the area, and I'm not very close to it, and I'm open that up.
I agree, and as you know, we're going to continue to work with you. Our staff is meeting with you on that particular issue, and we'll continue to do so. I want to say, you know, I'll continue to visit. I want to before we close, though, I want to thank our law enforcement that's been here. It's a sad day that we got to have law enforcement to come to a town hall meeting, and I want to say thank you for being here. I want to thank the sheriff publicly for being here. Been mouthing something to me. What?
I just wanted to come out and ask you guys.
Go ahead.
First of all, thank both of you.
You've been patient.
Very refreshing and engaging type conversation. Maybe help the next time you guys come and join some sharks about, you know, acceleration of the debt. It'd be nice to bring your brand new plan, your structure plan, your partner plan, what the company would look like, CEO with, and hold in meetings to show. My recommendation. A lot of the projections are in play long before the president came on the scene, so that's nothing new to us. That they were all the issues that I appreciate Congressman clarifying the issue that was delivering with this situation. We're not in war. It is a conflict. The president can have some leeway, and I appreciate him clarifying that he was supporting the UN resolution on that, and that's facts at stake versus just them both thinking that he's not in the long term. Lastly, it's always helpful to have not one part of controlling everything, not the other side. It's a little different issue than it was in 2012. Because since I've checked the balances, the problem is going to be in the past, we have to come down to the other work, and we have very hard needs to go to certain parts of the government to check the balance. That's what we have. And I think that's the problem with the next slide. You guys keep working.
Well said.
Thank you.
You're sitting in front of me.
One of the things that I'm upset about, my name is Voice Flight. I do Niceville. Is that I haven't heard really what the crux of all this issue is. We're upset about the wars in Libya, the wars in Iraq, the wars in Afghanistan. You see people say, well, broke. Well, folks, I'm going to tell you right now. Over $700 billion a year in energy costs overseas to that area that we're fighting in right now. It started in the 1960s and it is allowed to grow like a cancer over this country. And I've yet to see either party, come out with a really concrete plan of action and milestones on how we go about achieving energy independence without sacrificing the quality of life. Solar power and green power, folks, does not make economic sense. It cannot function in an industrialized 21st century country. You've got to learn to make it here. Now, unfortunately, what happened in Japan is basically going to give the people that are what I like to call it, the Luddites. You ever look at the Luddites? People are afraid of technology. Well, that reactor is 40 years old. It took the worst Mother Nature had. And guess what? When it's all said and done, after all the radiation's gone away, it's not going to be that major a problem 5 years from now. So I don't see it coming from the Republicans or the Democrats. It's something to